Now wake up, boys. Get out on the rock. It ain't daybreak, but it's 4 o'clock.
Oh, no, 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 Pops. You know that ain't the play.
What you talking about? It's the WBA.
Oh, the WBA.
Now, I said that.
The WBA. Sleep while you work, while you rest, while you play. Lean on your shovel to pass the time away. Tain't what you do, you can jive for your pay.
Why is that?
The WBA. WBA. WBA.
Now don't be a fool, working hard is passé. You'll stand from 5 to 6 hours a day. Sit down and joke while you smoke, it's okay. The WBA.
I'm so tired, don't know what to do. Can't get fired, so I'll take my rest until my work is through. The WBA. WBA. Don't mind the boss if he's cross when you're gay. He'll get a pink slip next month anyway. 3 little letters that make life okay. WBA.
Hello, moving on with Unit 6. It's time to talk about fiscal stabilization policy. We've got a familiarity with how the government collects taxes and basic categories of government spending. And now what we want to do is take a look at this question of, can government manipulation of their spending programs and tax policies impact the economy in a positive way, reduce unemployment, and improve economic growth? Okay. And to understand the core elements here of fiscal stabilization policy, it's going to help us to go back to Keynesian business cycle theory. And specifically, we want to remember that in Keynesian theory, a recession is caused by a negative aggregate demand shock, or a decrease in total spending growth in the economy. Well, we can therefore think about a solution in terms of government policy. If a decline in spending, a decline in aggregate demand causes the recession, it stands to reason that an increase in spending, an increase in aggregate demand, would cure the recession. So the question is, how can we use government fiscal policy to engineer a positive aggregate demand shock, an increase in total spending? And to put this in terms of our familiar aggregate expenditures equation, Y, GDP equals consumption spending plus investment spending plus government purchases, what's happening in a recession? Well, total spending is down, GDP's down, consumption spending's down a little bit, investment spending's down a lot. And the notion here is that if you can ramp up government spending, it can offset and cancel out the increases in consumption and investment spending, and we could reduce or maybe even reverse this decline in total spending, which corresponds to GDP. So you want to increase government purchases, and you want to remember this is government purchases, not just government spending, but government purchases. Most government spending is actually transfer programs, which just takes consumption from some people's pockets and gives it to other people's like that. Okay, that would be a transfer program. Things like Social Security, Medicare, welfare spending, mostly transfer programs. We're talking about government purchases. One thing we'll focus on with fiscal stimulus policy is capital spending or infrastructure, government infrastructure spending, where the government is actually hiring workers and buying materials and creating projects rather than just handing money to certain constituencies. Okay, so that's the gist of how fiscal stimulus policy is going to work. To further understand the essence of fiscal stimulus policy, I think it's very helpful to go back to the godfather of fiscal stimulus policy, John Maynard Keynes. Keynes advocated these kind of ideas in the Great Depression. President Franklin Roosevelt was elected U.S. president in 1932 at the depth of the Depression, and he began implementing the New Deal in 1933, which contained a lot of these kind of fiscal stabilization, fiscal stimulus policies, government employment, government works projects, increase in government spending to try to restore growth and employment in the economy. John Maynard Keynes, observing from Britain, observing the situation in the United States, and he commented in late 1933, after the first about the first 6 months of the Franklin Roosevelt presidency, And he wrote this open letter to Roosevelt, which appeared in the New York Times, in which he commented on what the Roosevelt administration had done so far on the grounds of fiscal policy, and he gave some advice and recommendation based on his viewpoints, which were quickly becoming influential, not only in the U.S., but all over the world. Okay. So let me give you a few excerpts from what Keynes said to Roosevelt. Keynes says, "The object of recovery is to increase the national output and put men to work. In the economic system of the modern world, output is primarily produced for sale, and the volume of output depends on the amount of purchasing power compared with the prime cost of production which is expected to come on the market." That's what we would call aggregate demand today. Continuing, he says, "An increase of output cannot occur unless by the operation of one or other of three factors. Individuals must be induced to spend more out of their existing incomes." And I'll comment on that. Is that going to happen when there's a recession on? Well, the answer is no. It's rational for individuals to cut back on their spending, okay, either because they lost their income or they're worried about losing their income. So that's, you're not going to be able to generate that and maintain people's economic freedom. Okay. So moving on, he says, "Well, the business world must be induced either by increased confidence or in the prospects," that meaning their prospects for their business, "or by a lower rate of interest to create additional current incomes in the hands of their employees." Well, again, why is business confidence down? It's because business is down. We're getting to a bit of a catch-22 here, because we can't increase business confidence until spending goes up. We can't increase people's spending until confidence goes up. Okay, so Keynes is going to rule that one out. And then we get to the last thing here, which where Keynes says, "Finally, public authority must be called in aid to create additional current incomes through the expenditure of borrowed or printed money." Okay. What he's talking about here is using the government as a spender, as an employer, as an investor of last resort. Okay. And Keynes's basic view is that when private industry falters through a loss of confidence, through these what he calls the animal spirits of the market, government needs to step in and ramp up its own spending to offset this and to maintain total income, to maintain what today we would call aggregate demand. Okay. And we can put this into our familiar aggregate supply and demand framework to think through how fiscal stimulus is supposed to work. Okay, so I start us off with a pretty familiar aggregate demand supply framework picture, where we've got 6% spending growth, so aggregate demand curve here, and that corresponds to 3% real growth, 3% inflation. We're on the solo curve, which means we're at long run potential growth, okay, and everything's hunky-dory. Now what happens in the Keynesian recession? So we've got a big collapse in aggregate demand like this. Okay, so aggregate demand is down like this. And you know, let's say inflation goes to zero, and growth maybe goes to -3, something along these lines, right here. And we could say aggregate demand growth falls to -3 here. Okay. The key thing to note here is that the solo curve did not shift. Okay, this is not a real shock. This is strictly an aggregate demand shock, and remember back to Unit 4, what causes this? Well, things like the fear, the lack of confidence, what you know, some relevant historical things are the big monetary shocks that hit during the Great Depression, things of that nature. Okay. But the point is that it's a needless decline in output due to the sticky wage effect, because we can't do the full adjustment through prices. Okay. If we could, we could stay on the solo curve right here by having just 6% deflation. -6 plus 3 is -3. But we can't have that. We know wages are sticky, so the short-run aggregate supply curve is going to flatten out here, and we get a little bit of disinflation, but we get also a big dip in real growth. Okay. So Keynes' mentality is that rather than suffering that dip in real growth, why don't we use what tools we can to reverse this decline and shift aggregate demand back up like this? Well, we've talked about this with respect to monetary policy. What is aggregate demand made of? What is the spending growth made of? It's made of money growth, delta M over M, plus velocity growth, delta V over V. Okay. Now, Keynes is actually going to be pretty skeptical about the ability of monetary policy. Monetary policy is not very well understood in the 1930s. Okay. But that's, of course, what the Fed would be doing with monetary policy, is focusing on money growth. Now, there's a little bit of reference to interest rate policy and things of that nature with Keynes in the 30s. But Keynes is going to focus on what he has a little more familiarity with, which is government budgets. Okay. Now, government budgets can't directly change money growth or velocity growth, but they can indirectly influence the level of spending and therefore the pace of spending. So fiscal policy we'll think about as operating on the velocity variable. And if government does expansionary fiscal policy, that could restore confidence, which would get velocity back up, and that would move the aggregate demand curve potentially back up to this level, and we could restore output growth up here to the full employment level, back on the solo curve. We could get inflation back maybe to a positive level, and we could cut short, or maybe avoid altogether if the government's very proactive, the pernicious effects of a pure aggregate demand-based recession. Okay, so this is how Keynesian fiscal stimulus policy is going to work in theory. Now, the main tool, as I've mentioned, with the Keynesian style, or what we might call demand-side fiscal stimulus, is to increase government spending. The government becomes the spender of last resort, the employer of last resort, the investor of last resort, if you will, by doing potentially quite large increases in the government expenditure. And let me give you a sense of this. Going back to Keynes' letter to President Roosevelt, 1933, Keynes says, "I lay overwhelming emphasis on the increase of national purchasing power resulting from governmental expenditure, which is financed by loans and not by taxing present incomes." Okay, what he's talking about is using deficit spending, government borrowing, and not tax increases, and that's very important. That's why I highlighted it here in red. It's a means of increasing government spending. Nothing else counts in comparison with this. What does he mean there? Well, he's talking about other policies, things like monetary policy, interest rate policy. Keynes is going to mention those things, but he thinks they're secondary at best. The government is the government budget authority. Government spending is going to be the most powerful, most proactive tool available in the view of people like Keynes. Okay. Now, I want us to note here, when you increase government spending financed by loans and not by taxation, that implies deficit. Okay. Fiscal policy implies deficits, and this is a theme I'm going to constantly come back to for reasons that we'll talk about a bit later on. Now, I also want to mention here, there is such a thing as supply-side fiscal policy, which is associated with the supply-side economists, people like Art Laffer, who we've encountered already. And supply-side policy is going to be focused on, instead of increasing government spending, reducing government taxation. Specifically, usually focuses on permanent tax rate reductions. And the idea here is that with lower tax rates, there are going to be greater incentives for people to earn incomes by working, investing. And what that means is more labor and capital is supplied, and we plug those we plug that into the solo model, and we realize we're going to have higher steady state long run growth rate. That's going to give us an aggregate supply stimulus. Now, there might be some merit to supply side fiscal stimulus policy, but what I want to note right now is that we talked about the Laffer curve effect. We might see an increase in government revenue when we decrease tax rates. Okay, and that, remember, that sounds counterintuitive, but remember that there's an incentive effect with the Laffer curve, as well as this direct revenue effect. It depends on where we are on the Laffer curve. But research on this show said that at least initially, when you cut tax rates, you're going to see lower tax revenues. Therefore, again, if we're doing supply-side stimulus, we're probably at least initially going to see bigger government deficits. Okay. And again, I'll come back to my big theme here, which is that fiscal policy implies deficits, whether we're doing it through demand side, whether we're doing it through supply side. And what we'll kind of find is a common theme in fiscal policy is that politicians are going to have temptations and tendencies to want to do both. Okay, increasing government spending is popular for reasons we'll discuss in some detail later on. Reducing tax rates is also popular with maybe a different set of people. Okay, well, if you do both of those at the same time, it's no surprise that you're going to wind up with bigger government deficits. Fiscal policy implies deficits. Okay, now kind of hold those thoughts for a while. Let's kind of come back to this question of how fiscal policy is supposed to work. Okay, there are some underlying key assumptions that have to be in place for fiscal policy to be effective. And I like to put this in terms of there's a very narrow window of opportunity for fiscal policy to be effective. These circumstances have to be prevailing. If these circumstances are not prevailing, as we'll see in the next lesson here, fiscal policy is going to be powerless, and in fact it can be counterproductive. But here's a situation where fiscal policy can be effective. Okay. And I'm going to kind of summarize the discussion that's given in the book and simplify a little bit. And this will help us to think about it, especially in historical terms. Okay, you've got to have a situation where there's a lot of, quote, idle resources in the economy. The Keynesians will refer to this as underutilization of capital or slack in the economy. What this means is that if there's a whole lot of resources that are perfectly good and perfectly useful, but they're not being employed because of slack demand, well, when the government steps in, there's very little opportunity cost for the government using these resources. They're sitting around doing nothing. Okay? And what they need is some impetus to put them back into employment, and because the private sector is not providing it, because of the demand slump and those perverse effects of the downwards aggregate demand spiral, the government can step in and proactively put these resources back to work. Okay? On a related front, we've got a view where there's idle financial resources, or just idle money. Money is being hoarded. That's a term used by the Keynesians quite a bit. They also refer to the phenomenon of a savings leak, wherein you have people saving more money, but it's not being channeled through banks and through financial institutions into investment and capital. It's just being held. It's being held sometimes literally in the form of cash hoards. People, and this was the case in the 1930s, people pull money out of the banks because they didn't trust the banks and they wanted to hold cash. Well, they're actually saving quite a bit of money, saving rates up, but the investment rate's way down. Okay, so there's financial resources available, but they're being held as cash and not invested. Okay, or there might be an overall breakdown in financing to where the financial institutions in the economy are not channeling savings into investment. And therefore, again, there's kind of a low opportunity cost for the government to step in and ramp up its borrowing. Remember, fiscal policy is all about deficit spending. We're going to ask the question is, where does the government get the money from? Well, there's a lot of money just kind of sitting around in the economy, not doing anything already, so there's room for the government to increase its borrowing so it can increase its spending. Okay. Finally, and the textbook is going to talk about this in terms of fiscal lags. I like the terminology of the shovel-ready projects, which we saw in reference to the 2009 government stimulus program. What we're talking about here is that the money the government's going to allocate to increase government purchases has to be able to be spent quickly on government projects that are ready to go. Okay. We also want to focus on government projects that create actual productive capital, sound investment, and things like infrastructure. Okay, we might be talking about road building. Okay, we might be talking about financing research, but we want the government to spend the money wisely. Okay, if government just hires a bunch of people to dig ditches and fill them back in, that'll increase those people's incomes, but is that a productive use of labor? The answer is clearly no. And wasteful uses of labor, wasteful uses of capital are not going to help the economy. They might make people feel good about themselves because they have an income, but it's not going to help us in the big picture. So we want the government to have some projects, some worthwhile, sound capital type infrastructure projects ready to go, and ready to go rather quickly, so this stimulus can be effective. Okay. Now, Historically, when we think about Keynesian fiscal stimulus, we can think about the New Deal of the 1930s, and we want to think about, do these circumstances apply? These are the key assumptions necessary for fiscal stimulus to be effective. Okay, let's think about, are they applicable in the Great Depression? Well, first off, with the idle resources, the idle labor, here's a picture of some of the bread lines back in the 30s. We have 25% unemployment in 1933. Arguably, this is mostly cyclical unemployment. In other words, while there's some real shocks, this is probably mostly cyclical, meaning, yeah, there's some perfectly good resources, labor and capital, that are just being idle due to an aggregate demand shock. Okay, so probably the case, yes, that we have the so-called slack in the economy. Secondly, idle cash. Way to think about this in the 1930s is through a monetary statistic known as the currency ratio. This is the ratio of currency to bank deposits. Actually, it's called the currency deposit ratio. And what's going on here? This is the amount of currency in the economy divided by the amount of bank deposits. When this number is low, that means there's a lot of money in the bank, and banks have a lot of money. They're able to channel that into investment and capital spending. When this ratio is high, that means people are pulling money out of the bank and they have a stronger preference to hold currency rather than bank deposits. Well, notice what happens here in the late 1800s into the early 1900s. The ratio starts off pretty low and it just goes down, okay? And right here it's pretty low. That means there's money in the banks and the banks can finance a lot of activity. Look what happens in the early 1930s with the banking crisis and the banking panics here. This ratio shoots up. Okay, this means people are yanking money out of the banks. Okay? And this is hampering the ability of banks to finance investment. Okay, there's a lot of saving. There's hardly any investing. Okay, and that is crucial. That's a crucial implication for fiscal policy. It says that maybe the government can come in, tap that huge amount of savings, and finance some of its own investment with very little opportunity cost in terms of displacing private investment. Okay, so we can probably conclude that yes, this situation is also prevalent in the Great Depression. Okay, finally, when we think about, are there productive government capital projects ready to go? Well, in the Great Depression, the government is going to take some time, but there are actually lots of projects that have already been started. Okay, and the government's going to create a bunch of new ones. And well, later on we'll talk about, are all these projects going to be sound and efficient uses of capital? Well, maybe not, but a lot of them are. Okay, and we'll look at things like, here's the picture of the Grand Coulee Dam, which is strictly a New Deal government capital project. It created hydroelectric power and irrigation up in the northwest, up in Washington State. I was initially going to show the Hoover Dam here. The Hoover Dam actually was initiated before the Great Depression. It was not technically a New Deal policy, okay, but arguably it was a prime example of the kind of project that we want fiscal policy to pursue, a capital project that employs lots of people and it produces something of lasting value for the economy. Okay, it produces actual capital. But there are many examples. We can look at the Tennessee Valley Authority in the South. That's a similar hydroelectric project. Hydroelectric was big back then. Government did a lot of road building. Okay, government did a lot of public works, all kinds of stuff all over the country. So there were many of these kind of projects available. So to at least certain extent, we can put the check mark there as well. Okay. We can say the fiscal policy. Now, I'm not necessarily endorsing the view that fiscal policy saved the day and brought the U.S. out of the Great Depression. But I'm willing to say that the Great Depression is a prime example of when fiscal policy can be effective. Okay? There's other reasons that we might critique fiscal policy, even in this kind of ideal fiscal policy situation of a Great Depression. Okay? But we definitely want to realize that, yes, that those are the ideal situations for when fiscal policy is called for. Okay? Fiscal stimulus. Okay, and this comes from the textbook. This kind of summarizes what I just talked about. Fiscal policy works best when, According to the book, they said the economy needs a short-run boost, even at the expense of the long run. Okay. We'll talk about the reasons fiscal policy can hurt in the long run. The main thing is going to be that it implies higher future taxes, which can cut down on future growth. We'll discuss that in a little more detail in the next unit, the next lesson. Of course, we want to focus on situations where they're dealing with aggregate demand shocks and not real shocks, okay, not supply shocks. Just like with monetary policy, fiscal policy cannot cure real shocks, it just create inflation. Okay. And finally, when we've got a lot of, quote, slack in the economy, when many resources are unemployed, and note, they're unemployed for cyclical reasons, not for structural reasons. If it's structural reasons, that's more like a real shock, and fiscal policy probably can't fix that. I'm going to add in a little caveat here, which I'm going to focus on quite a bit in further lessons, which is we want to remember that we're still talking about politicians being the ones doing the spending. Okay? We still have this nagging question of, well, does politics use resources wisely? Maybe not. Okay? Sometimes yes, but often not. And we want to keep our behavioral assumption here in mind. Assume all men are knaves, and I'll say assume all men are knaves, especially politicians. Okay, and we'll talk about these problems of political incentives later on. For now, that's kind of the conditions for fiscal policy in a nutshell. What we'll look at in the next lesson here is this question of, well, okay, fiscal policy may be all well and good, but we still need to address this question of where are they going to get the money? Okay, whether they're doing tax finance or deficit finance fiscal policy, we cannot escape the question of where does the money ultimately come from. And that'll lead us into critiques of fiscal policy, crowding out, and equivalence theory, which we'll cover next. Stay tuned.